但是后来
welcome you to the Young Turks. That's what I need to do. Jeez, I'm Lord mercy, we're going to put on a show for you today. In the second hour, do we have sex toy bandits? Why, I'm glad you asked. Indeed, we do. Why are they stealing sex toys, and what do they plan to do with them? You're going to love that story. Ciara, was she too naked during the college football championship? We're going to have that story for you. That's what we do. But in the first hour, well, look, I'm going to get to it in a second. Here comes back. Okay. And then we've got an exclusive on Trump right here on the Young Turks today. Look at our campaign reporters in the field getting exclusives. Okay. Also, later in the program, that you won't see in the first segment, MoveOn endorses Bernie Sanders. We'll tell you the significance of that. Hillary Clinton is on the attack. Interesting. And then the story of a woman who took her four-year-old with her as she went to join ISIS. And how disastrous a decision that was. Okay, that story is amazing. If it wasn't more serious, I would call it amazeballs. Okay, but it is serious, so keep it real. Bring it down. Now, wait a minute, bring it back up, because here comes Bernie. Let's do the first story. Oh my God, it's real. Bernie isn't coming. It's already here. Yesterday on the program, I told you, oh my, he's coming, man. He's in the lead in New Hampshire, and he almost caught Hillary Clinton in Iowa. Whoa! He did catch her. He caught her immediately. The very next day, new poll, Quinnipiac. Let me show you. Wait a minute, I don't see Hillary Clinton up top there. What do I see up there? Oh, look at that. Bernie Sanders. Feel the burn. 49-44. He's already passed Hillary Clinton in Iowa. Now, this is trending now, not just one poll. All the polls are trending towards Bernie Sanders as we get closer to Iowa. Now, before, I would tell you, hey, polls, don't get too excited, don't get too discouraged. We're really far out. Now, we are not really far out. We're only 3 weeks from Iowa. And the troops have amassed. The establishment has no idea what it's about to hit them. Look, I've been telling you this from day one, which is people are pissed. They're not, they hate the establishment. They hate politics as usual. And but the establishment doesn't get it because they don't want to get it. They don't want to get it through their thick skulls. They are the establishment. Oh, no, Bernie has no chance. No, he's got no chance. Right. Now, I've been telling you he does have a chance. I've been telling you the establishment is wrong and that we that this fervor exists. And I didn't do this because I'm in favor of that fervor, which I am. Okay. I told you that not as part of wishful thinking because it's real. Things like Dave Brat beating Eric Cantor in a Republican race, defeating a sitting majority leader in the House, unprecedented. Why did he do that? Because Dave Brat ran a populist campaign on the right-wing side. So these are real movements. People are to take down a majority leader. And Dave Brat ran a campaign against the banks. Now, he did it from the right. Oh, wait till you get a load of it from the left. So on the one hand, you have Hillary Clinton saying, look, the banks are, it's important, and we have to balance, da, da, da. And then Bernie Sanders comes out, no, here's what we're going to do. We're going to break them up. Here, Citigroup, break your back. Let's move on. Okay, hey, oh, JP Morgan, you're up next. Next, move on, right? He says he's going to break up the six biggest banks in the country. And then you know what he said? He's going to cap credit card rates as 15%. Now, that is so liberal, it's a position I don't agree with. But when you go tell people, hey, you know what? From now on, your credit card's going to be capped at 15%. And not going to be 29%, not going to be 80%. It's going to be 15%. You're not going to pay ATM fees, and your kids are going to get to go to school for free. You know what? It turns out, if you actually design a campaign for real Americans instead of for the donor class and billionaires, real Americans like it. The revolution is afoot. Now, let me show you the tide that's rolling in. According to The Hill, this Iowa drop for Hillary Clinton, quote, it is a significant drop for the former Secretary of State from last month's Quinnipiac poll, which had her up by 11%. She was up by 11% last month. Now, she's down by 5%. I can do the quick math for you. That's a 16-point swing in just 1 month. Bernie is not coming. He's already here. Knock, knock. Who's there? Ooh, it's hot. Oh, the burn is here. Okay. Well, I got a lot more numbers with you. For you. Now, that's Iowa. But what do I hear? New Hampshire. He's close to Vermont. Iowa, maybe the caucus and the impassioned supporters. But no, nationwide. Now, I told you all along, nationwide is all about name recognition. But as we get closer to the election, people start paying attention. It stops being less about name recognition. Okay? So, now with 3 weeks left, here we go. With just 21 days until the presidential primaries officially begin in Iowa, Hillary Clinton's support among Democrats nationally has taken a serious tumble, falling 8 points to 43%. According to the latest IBD TIPP poll, support for her chief rival, Bernie Sanders, rose 6 points to 39%. These are all different polls. Iowa, New Hampshire, now nationally, all three different polling organizations, yesterday and today, all saying the same thing. He's not coming. He's already here. Nationally, he was so far behind. Hillary Clinton has gigantic name recognition. He had very little name recognition, and plus TV didn't even cover him. He's only 4 points behind her nationally. They have no idea what's about to happen. More from this poll. As a result, Clinton's lead over Sanders, which had been 18 points, is now just 4 points. All right, let's get into the details. The IBTIPP poll shows that regionally, Clinton saw her support drop most in the Northeast, where it fell to 36% from 50%. She lost 14 points in the Northeast. And the West, down to 37% from 49%. She lost 12 points in the West. Sanders now holds the lead in both places. He is leading in the Northeast. He's leading in the West. You know, there's a word for someone who's leading in all these different areas. It's called front runner. Okay, hold. It, because they say, no, Bernie Sanders, he's too liberal. He's a liberal. The liberal's not going to win because all the moderate Democrats are going to support Hillary Clinton. Really? Let's look at the numbers again. She has lost backing among moderate Democrats, falling to 44% from 58%. Now, when TV was pounding that message in free ads for Hillary Clinton, the moderates will support Hillary Clinton, the moderates will support Hillary Clinton, she was at 58%. They started paying attention and looking at the actual policies. Mm-mm. They are not supporting Hillary Clinton. Moderates now running in a sprint towards Bernie Sanders. Now, what is the reaction in the Clinton campaign? I now go to CNN. Quote, a sense of anxiety is cascading through Hillary Clinton's campaign. Oh, I wish I could be a fly on that wall. Okay, here's what's happening. Cascading. Anxiety. What is that? What's I feel? Oh no. I feel the burn. He's already here. It's real. I gotta explain something to you. Bernie Sanders might be the next president of the United States of America. When you could put him up against the Republicans, he's murdering them. So I'm gonna get to that next. First, let me finish up Hillary Clinton's reaction. Clinton released a campaign ad in Iowa and New Hampshire asserting that she's the only one who can beat whoever the Republican Party nominates. Really? Well, that's what she's been saying all along. It's, hey, don't go for Bernie Sanders, then Trump will be president. Don't go for Bernie Sanders, then Cruz will be president. Well, let's take a look at the numbers and see if that's true. Now, this is a poll that came out yesterday, Wall Street Journal, NBC News, and Marist. So, well, when you look at New Hampshire voters, it's true, Hillary Clinton is beating Donald Trump by 1 point, right? Well, that's a pretty narrow lead in 1 point. That doesn't seem too impressive. It's 45-44, right? Now, New Hampshire's a swing state. Forget that it's an early primary state. In the general election, it's a swing state, so it's important in that sense, okay? Now, Bernie Sanders probably losing to Donald Trump, right? Wrong! Bernie Sanders, in that swing state, is murdering Donald Trump. He's beating him by 19 points. You want to know who's more electable? Well, you need swing states, don't you? You need purple states, don't you? New Hampshire's a purple state. Hillary Clinton's like, oh, 1 point, oh my God, Trump might beat me. Bernie Sanders like, Trump, who's Trump? Who's your secular? Okay. Come here again, Trump. Come here again. Okay. Now, well, maybe he's not doing as well against Ted Cruz. All right, first Hillary Clinton versus Ted Cruz in the swing state of New Hampshire. She's losing. She's losing by 4 points to that maniac, Ted Cruz. Who's more electable? I can't hear you. Who's more electable? I'm having trouble understanding who's more electable. Because it looks like she's losing to Ted Cruz by 4 points. Well, to be fair, Ted Cruz, I guess, a little bit better. I probably Bernie Sanders losing to him, right? Wrong! He's beating him by 19 points! He's beating Trump by 19 points. He's beating Ted Cruz by 19 points. She's losing to Cruz. All right, let's pause here. Understand something. He has a 23-point advantage in electability against Cruz. 18-point advantage against Trump. Those are not small numbers. Those are gigantic numbers. I know, the pundits. I could hear them now on Morning Joe. But, we don't really like Bernie. He scares us. He might take away all of our footage. I mean, he's unelectable. No. This means Hillary Clinton's unelectable. Okay, now, so what are those skeptics going to tell me on Morning Joe? Oh, that's New Hampshire. Well, Bernie Sanders is from Vermont. It's a nearby state. Blah, 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 that nonsense. Okay? All right, well, let's go to Iowa. Maybe they're right. So, now, Iowa is, I got news for you. I've looked at the map. Nowhere near Vermont. And Iowa is considered a more conservative state. Also a swing state. Also purple. Also incredibly important in the general election. Well, there, Hillary Clinton's doing really well against Donald Trump. I can give her credit, right? She's beating Donald Trump by 8 points. 48-40. Also, Bernie probably not doing as well. Wrong! Bernie beating him by 13 points. So, remind me who's more electable. No. For the moment being, it appears that conversation is close to over. And it's not over in Hillary Clinton's direction. So every time you hear a pundit say that Hillary Clinton is more electable, understand that they're either grossly ignorant, haven't done any of their homework, don't know any of the numbers, or they're lying to you, and for what purpose? You figure that out, okay? They either know it and they're lying to you, or they're idiots. They don't know anything about politics. If you actually look at the numbers. Who's more electable? It's a landslide that Bernie Sanders is more electable. So Hillary Clinton, you want to run campaign ads saying, hey, vote for the person who's more electable. Be careful what you wish for. You just might get it. So, now look, you might like Bernie Sanders. You might like Hillary Clinton. However you fall out on that, it doesn't really matter. What I'm here to report to you is numbers and facts. And what the facts tell you is Bernie Sanders has an excellent chance. And if he wins Iowa and New Hampshire, and he's already only 4 points behind her in the national polling, you have any idea the momentum that he will grab, the headlines that he will grab? Then TV doesn't have a choice. The internet's already all over Bernie Sanders. We've already got the information. Who's the more progressive candidate? Is that really a contest? That's not a contest. And we're in a Democratic primary. So when TV is forced to cover Bernie Sanders, and if he wins those two states and he has that momentum, I got news for you. It's real. The next commander-in-chief could very well be Bernie Sanders. So before I was telling you about the anti-establishment fervor and how it was a possibility, it is now moving to probability. And whoever Bernie Sanders is against in the Republican race, I'm not saying it's going to be easy. There's going to be ups and downs. Okay, these numbers will also move, and yes, it's a long way away from the general election. But given how well he's doing with independents, and every poll says the same thing, independents really like Bernie Sanders. Again, exact opposite of what the TV pundits are telling you. Why? Because independents are looking at Hillary Clinton going, standard politician, establishment. I'm sick of the establishment. I can't take it anymore. Standard politician. Bernie, not a standard politician. And he's telling me my kids get to go to school for free if they're smart kids and they earn their way into college. He's telling me I got to pay interest, but I'm going to pay it at 15%. He's telling me that he's going to stop those big banks from having all the advantages and all the donors from having all the advantages, and he's going to give us a fair shot? Yeah, of course he's popular with independents. Today is the day when it got real. Bernie Sanders, of all people, the next president of the United States. It is enormously possible. If you're not feeling the burn, because you're not paying attention, the burn is all around. I love this. Isn't this fun? God damn, man. I'm telling you, man, there's a special day. There's a moment in the air. I even talked to my old friend, Epic Politics Man. Epic Politics Man, Michael Schur. That dude's in the field, man. John and JR were in Iowa yesterday to cover that forum for Fusion, you know, for the Young Turks, but along with Fusion. And they ran into Epic, right? You get a great picture on Instagram, you should check it out. I forgot whose account it's on. Anyway, and I was talking to Michael, and I'm like, you know, it's official, Bernie can win. And he's, you know, I love the brother. But he's like, well, I don't know about that. I was like, Michael, man, your beard is singed, and you don't even realize. Shit got real exciting, man. It's exciting. Maybe never seen a race like this in my life. Okay. All right. So let's talk about that next. Let's go to the next one. Okay. Now, over the last couple of days, Bernie Sanders has caught and passed Hillary Clinton in Iowa. He's already leading in New Hampshire. He's almost caught her in the national polling. Only 3 weeks left before Iowa. So here comes a populist wave on the left side. Now, on the right side, that populist wave has already crashed. Not on top of all of our heads, that's also in the middle of happening, but mainly on top of the Republican establishment's heads. And that comes in the form of Donald Trump. So let's check in on his numbers, see how he's doing. Well, Ted Cruz has been beating him for a while in Iowa, and the voting's only 3 weeks away, so let's check in to see if Cruz is holding on to his lead. Nope. New Quinnipiac poll, Trump back on top. Okay, now it's just 2 points, but there was a poll yesterday that also had him up by a point. So now we're trending towards Donald Trump. What has Donald Trump done to take down Ted Cruz? Well, he's a right-winger. So he used the oldest right-wing trick in the book. Racism. He's like, there's not a lot of evangelicals coming out of Cuba. What does that mean? Okay, Ted Cruz is evangelical, so he came out of Cuba, so what? Why would you say that? You would say that, Ted Cruz, he's not white. When you're in Iowa, what are you going to do? To vote for the non-white guy? And then he did the birther thing on him. I mean, was he really born here? I mean, he wasn't. He was born in Canada, right? Is he really a citizen? And all of a sudden, people are like, Ted Cruz, I don't know about that Ted Cruz guy. Donald Trump, there's one thing I know about him. He's white. Okay. Now, I tell you all that, yes, that is some of the dirty tricks he's played, and he's played many dirty tricks, and he's got that whole racism, fascism thing going. I got it, okay? But do not discount the other reason why Donald...
Sorry, man.
I get up here, and you can tell, I don't know what I'm talking about. Right? I'm speaking off the top of my head. There's no prompter, there's no nothing, there's no donors, there's no strings, right? There might be crazy head up here and hair, but there's no strings. I'm not a puppet. And people go, ooh, like that. People on the right like it, people on the left like it. They've gravitated towards two enormously different individuals. But one thing is absolutely clear. Not in favor of the establishment. Can't stand the establishment. Enough of that. And by the way, that is happening all across the world. Greece went significantly left. Canada went significantly left. Eastern Europe went significantly right. So people are saying, hey, whatever it is, I don't want the same old, same old. The same old, same old has been screwing us for decades. It's time to try something new. And America right now is at an unbelievable juncture where you have the idea and the probability at this point that it is going to be Trump versus Sanders. No one could have possibly imagined that race. What an unbelievably fascinating race. And most importantly, a race that clearly gives Americans a choice. You want to go right or you want to go left. We're done with the centrist establishment guys who have all agreed. They say there's no bipartisanship in Washington. That's not remotely true. Whenever it comes to giving donors whatever they want, oil companies, banks, pharmaceutical companies, there's enormous bipartisan agreement. But we're done with that agreement. We're either going to go right or we're going to go left. Now, again, back to Trump. How badly is he beating these guys? Well, let's look at the national numbers. On the GOP side, Donald Trump extended his lead over his GOP rivals with 34% now backing the real estate tycoon, up from 27%. His support is now nearly equal to his three closest rivals combined. You think Trump's not real? Those pundits on TV have been telling you he's not real for months and months and months. They're not getting it, man. We don't want your stinking politicians. So the right wing's saying, you take all those lousy politicians, wrap them up all together, and Trump is beating all top three combined, okay? Now, we're told also by those pundits, well, you know, he's an extremist. Now, the reality is, Trump is massively extreme in a lot of different ways in terms of policy, right? But is his appeal not going to be to the moderates? They tell us, I mean, how many times have you heard this on TV? The moderates are either going to vote for Jeb Bush or Marco Rubio or John Kasich. Really? Let's look at the numbers and find out. Although Trump depicts himself as an outsider and a conservative, he does far better among moderate and liberal Republicans than his rivals. 39% of moderates support Trump, and 68% of liberal Republicans.
798 miles
of moderate cavalry. You see Jeb Bush or Marco Rubio. I got bad news for you. They ain't coming. They already switched sides. They're already in Trump's zone. Because it isn't just about the extreme rhetoric he uses. It's about that idea of, I'm not bought. I'm my own man, and I will do whatever's in my crazy head and whatever's in your crazy head. But I'm not going to do what the donors tell me to do. I'm not going to listen to the millionaires and the billionaires. I don't need them because I'm a billionaire. I'm my own man. You have no idea how much that resonates with Republican voters. It also resonates in Democratic voters. Now, Donald Trump isn't going to do anything about the corrupt system, right? But he is a symbol fighting against the corrupt system, at least in the right-wingers' minds. And that's why it's so powerful. There is no cavalry. Jeb Bush should quit today. He has 0% chance. Let alone the rest of them. If you think Trump is not the most likely candidate for the Republicans, you're not getting it. It's not over. A lot of time between now and then, and Trump is a time bomb, so he can say something even crazier than he's already said that might actually hurt him. Okay, but is he the likely nominee? Is he the front runner? Where's the question? Of course he's the front runner by a landslide at this point. I got to say, one last aside they had in this polling, which I was amused by, that talk of the moderate and liberal Republicans. They added quickly thereafter. The numbers in these categories were very small, however, making the findings less conclusive. Which, again, goes to another point I've been saying all along. What moderate and liberal Republican? That cavalry is so small that when those three dudes show up at Jeb Bush's rally, it ain't going to make a difference anyway. Besides which, we just found out two of them went over to Trump's rally. We are on the verge of a historic election where America is going to have to choose between left and left. And you're going to have, it's enormously possible now. You're going to have very, very clear choices. This is not politics as usual. This is completely unusual. So buckle up. This election just got amazing. Okay. If you think that's interesting, God damn, I love this job. Damn it, I love this job. All right, let's go to another story about Trump. But while we do that, let's ironically take a Rubio break. Why did he lean in like that? Dude, take the water after it's done with the State of the Union. Okay, by speaking of which, by the way, State of the Union tonight, no, Marco Rubio will not be giving the response, though that would be awesome. It's going to be Nikki Haley. Okay, we're going to cover that live on the Young Turks, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific, at tyrtnetwork.com/live. Okay, now let's bring it to. We've got a Young Turks exclusive now. Our reporter, Jordan Cheriton, is in Burlington, Vermont. He went to the Flynn Theater, where Trump was holding a rally. He's there with Eric Beiler, who's the producer and camera person there. As you're going to see here, they're going to be part of the story. Because they're taping inside the rally, and they got some of the closest footage we've ever seen of people being thrown out of Trump rallies. In fact, Eric, the producer, got thrown out himself for committing an act of journalism, so we'll get to that in a second. But first, this is a new level at the Trump rallies, where Trump is egging on the crowd even more. What you're going to see in this first clip is Trump talking about how the security should get tougher and tougher and intimidate the protesters to the point where they don't show up. So that's scary talking in and of itself. But as they throw out the protesters, he's going to tell them to confiscate their property and throw them out in the cold. That sounds like an exaggeration, right? I mean, how much closer to fascism can we get? Well, let's watch for ourselves here. I know what Trump says. Trump says he's kidding around. And people laugh, but they do throw people out. And they do have tougher and tougher security measures as they throw people out. And in the end, you'll see that they might have thrown out a wrong person. But first, in this first video, you're going to see all that I was telling you about throwing out the first set of protests.
Get more and more angry as we go along. And by the end, I'll say, get them the hell out of here. And then, by the way, by that time, the security will be so tough and so nasty. And you know what's going to happen when that happens? You're not going to have any more problems. You're not going to have any more problems. Did you notice the first group, the security guys are going, please come with us, and they're screaming, please come. Second group, they're running. Now, the last time, they're starting to get nasty. Pretty soon, they're going to get so nasty that we're not going to have any more protesting. You know that, right? Don't give him his coat. Don't give him his coat. Keep his coat. Confiscate his coat. You know, it's about 10 degrees below zero outside.
So funny. Confiscating people's property. I think I've seen that somewhere before. How'd that turn out? Throwing them out in the cold. I think I've seen that before as well. There's guys screaming, drag them out! Drag them out! You know, and it's in the full video. Please go to youtube.com/TYTpolitics. Jordan's been doing some great reporting there. He interviewed Jeb Bush in an earlier stop. There's more protesters being thrown out in other rallies. In this video, you see how they explain before the rally, hey, when Mr. Trump comes on, there'll be protesters. And you're to point them out, don't hurt them. Okay, point them out, and then start aggressively screaming Trump, Trump, Trump at them. So that Trump chant doesn't come out of nowhere. It wasn't organic from the audience. It's the Trump campaign telling them to get in the protesters' face and yell, Trump, 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 right? So watch the whole video on TYT Politics. But there you see we're going to get more and more angry, and the security is going to get tough and nasty, so tough and nasty, we might not have protesters anymore. If it's joking around, I'm no longer amused. This is exactly how fascism starts. You start roughing people up, and you get your own supporters to rough them up. You start taking their stuff. You start throwing them out in the cold. And we've shown you how many videos of now black protesters, Latino protesters, all sorts of protesters, female protesters thrown to the ground, roughed up, ropes. Comments like, light the motherfucker up, right? That was another rally. Here, drag him out, drag him out. Now, how about the press? He's always joking about how he's going to contain the press, punish the press, kick the press out. Well, our camera person there, Eric Beiler, and our producer, is recording on Periscope. Let's find out what happened to this journalist.
Eric, our producer and cameraman, also was shut down. He was periscoping from back there while shooting the actual event, and they made him shut that down. Eric was actually assigned a Trump staffer to shadow him and make sure that he would not shoot anything but Donald Trump.
Now, understand what's happening. These are members of the press. They're working for the Young Turks. They're taping the event. They are followed by Trump campaign people. And if they swerve their camera to anything but Mr. Trump, they're removed from the building. Does that sound like a free press to you? Like, if there's a protester being removed and Eric moves his camera, okay, that's it, you're gone, you're trespassing, and you're out of here. That's not a free press. This is what they do in authoritarian countries. And it's happening. It's happening right now. It just happened today. Okay, now finally, I think that this is actually the scariest part. Our reporter Jordan Cheriton was sitting next to this, or near this woman, and these supporters of Trump who have been empowered now to find the guilty, to find the people who have transgressed against them, swarmed on this woman who we don't believe was a protester. And you'll see her complaining now, but it doesn't matter. The crowd has seized her. Watch what happens. Now, we were not able to confirm if she was a Trump supporter or a Trump opponent. We don't know. But we do know that Jordan was sitting close to her. She did not say a word. She didn't protest. She didn't get up. Why did they pick her up? We don't know, right? But that's the thing about a crowd. Once you got a mob mentality, it's him, it's her, it's him, let's get him. You got to go get him out, get him out. So now it's everywhere. If you think this isn't dangerous, you're not paying attention. This is exactly what has happened in countries in the past. This is not how it ends. Okay, we're very, very far from the ending. We haven't even chosen yet whether we're going to go in this direction or not. Okay, but this is how it begins. When you start that mob and you empower that mob, you say, go get it. Are they always going to get the right guy? Whether it's protesters doing the most American thing you can do, exercising your freedom of speech. I know that at some point protesters have to be removed. I know that. But they're angry. How dare you? Angry. Get the mob again. Trump, 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 Trump. Whether it's go get the press, remove them from the building if they don't listen to strict orders on how you are to cover Mr. Trump, the politician, right? So, and then finally, right guy, wrong guy, press, not press, who cares? Just get them. This is exactly how fascism begins. Young Turks. lot more show for you guys. We got to go. State of the Union, everybody. 5:45 p.m. Pacific, 8:45 p.m. Eastern today. TYTnetwork.com/live. So that's happening tonight. Jimmy, Ben, Johnny Pie. Johnny Pie's back. I feel like I haven't seen him in a while. All right. Just coming back from Iowa, and we'll all do the State of the Union play-by-play coverage for you guys. Pre-game, post-game, all that good stuff. Now, I got a lot of international stories for you, so let's do it. Another day, another terrorist bombing. This one is in Turkey, and it was in the heart of Istanbul, in the area that is most frequented by tourists, and it did target tourists and killed tourists. Let me tell you more. A suicide bomber thought to have crossed recently from Syria, according to Reuters, killed at least 10 people, most of them German tourists, in Istanbul's historic heart on Tuesday. They go on to explain at Reuters that all those killed in Sultanahmet Square near the Blue Mosque and the Hagia Sophia, major tourist site in the center of one of the world's most visited cities, were foreigners, Davutoğlu said. He is the prime minister of Turkey. The senior Turkish official said 9 were German, while Peru's foreign ministry said a Peruvian man also died. Now, let me show you where this attack happened. This is, like I said, at the very center of Turkey's tourism industry. So we've done stories about how the Turkish government seemed to have at least played along with shuffling weapons in and oil out of ISIS-held territories, perhaps working with some ISIS figures. Well, they wouldn't be working with them in this case. It appears that it is ISIS, but it seems nearly inconceivable that the Turkish government would be happy with a terrorist bombing in the heart of Istanbul that would terribly affect their tourism industry, let alone the fact that all those poor people got murdered. Now, in the past, there have been bombings where the Turkish government, unfortunately, seemed to have turned a blind eye. There was a bombing near the Syrian border. They said it was ISIS, and then there was a Kurdish peace protest in Ankara, the capital, where over 100 people were killed, and not a lot of police protection there. Now, in this case, there was no major event, so you would have normal police protection, but I can't imagine the Turkish government is happy about this turn of events. So finally, they seem to be a little angry at what they call Daesh. Now, of course, they claim they've been angry all along, although some troubling reports about that. Now, Davutoğlu, the prime minister, reached out to Angela Merkel, since most of the people who were killed were Germans. And then he went on and talked to the press and said, until we wipe out Daesh, that's their name for ISIS, Turkey will continue its fight at home and with coalition forces. And he said that they would significantly punish the perpetrators, find them, hunt them down, and all the things that leaders say after their country has been bombed. So now we have some video footage of what happened at the scene. I want to show you that as I tell you a little bit more about this attack.
Mustafa abi, canlı bomba. Mustafa abi. Canlı bomba, canlı bomba. Ölüler var şu anda. Çok sayıda yaralı ve ölü var, evet. Tamam abi, tamam. Bak uzaklaştım, tamam.
Okay, so that's where the police are saying it's a live bomb. It's a live bomb. There are people who've been murdered. There's a lot of dead and wounded, and then you see, obviously, people rushing in to help. So these terrorists have terrorized us all. You know, this is what we've been saying from day one, whether it was attacks here in the United States, Paris, and mostly, honestly, in the Middle East. So Iraq has been devastated with terrorist attacks. Afghanistan, Syria, now neighboring countries like Lebanon, Turkey, with giant bombing after giant bombing. So these guys who claim to be protectors of the faith in regards to Islam, they're Islamic radicals. Everybody's got their own interpretation of all the different religions. They claim that they're the true leaders, and then religious figures in these countries say, no, ISIS is the exact opposite of Islam. I'm not here to judge that. I read the book, and to me it looks like they both have a case to make. The Quran, just like the Bible, is in parts benevolent and talks a lot about helping your fellow man and feeding the poor, and in parts is horrific and talks about killing everybody that disagrees with you. And if you think the Bible doesn't do the same, you're misinformed. Okay. Now, Christian radicals didn't do this, though. Islamic radicals did. Now, who did they target? They targeted, in this case, Turks. And in other cases, in Beirut, they targeted Shiite Muslims, who were also Muslims, but not good enough. Not according to their interpretation. No, it's not good enough to be a Muslim, you got to be Sunni. And if you're a Sunni, it's not good enough to be a Sunni, you have to believe in their particular interpretation. This is why I don't believe in religion, because it just leads people down a dark hole where they can choose to take the horrific parts of the text and use that against us. So, yes, we've talked about this a lot in the past. There are radicals in each faith, and the Christian radicals would like Armageddon, where almost everybody on the planet dies. They think that that's like a wonderful scenario where Jesus comes back and murders almost everyone, okay? I don't find that to be a wonderful scenario, and they push for that through the foreign policy of the greatest military ever built, the U.S. military. So state violence is enormously important. Those guys anywhere near any trigger is a problem, and the U.S. Air Force, unfortunately, in stories we've covered, is littered with evangelicals that can't wait for Armageddon where we all die. That's a dangerous situation. This dangerous situation is more immediate. So, yes, the state violence is also immediate. Yes, the occupation exists. Yes, the U.S. does bombings throughout the world. Yes, Saudi Arabia is vicious in their state violence, both internally and externally. What they're doing in Yemen now is literally a war crime. Okay? But terrorism is also massively vicious. Those poor Germans. What do? They went to a Muslim country, in this case Turkey, and they were going to look at their mosques. And these guys who claim to represent Islam come into a Muslim country, bomb it, and hurt those innocent people who wanted to find out more about Islam or just wanted to go have a nice vacation in a nice country like Turkey. And now the blood is everywhere. What's the answer? The answer is you have to defeat them culturally. And I don't mean it's the Christian culture versus the Muslim culture or the Western culture versus Eastern culture. Once you've done that, you've helped the terrorists with the game they want to play. They want to pretend that all Muslims are on one side, all Christians are on another side, that this is a religious fight. Religious fundamentalists love religious fights. That's not what we want. Now, at the same time, you have to acknowledge that it is a cultural issue. So what is it? It's the fundamentalism. Us people who are secular, who are moderates, who are logical, who are reasonable, need to understand what the actual problem is. The actual problem is it's religious nut jobs who can't wait for war with one another, trying to push all of the rest of us into that war. They do it with bombing, they do it with state violence, they do it with terrorism, they do it with all these different things until we're all caught in the middle. I can't stand it anymore. I don't want to be caught in the middle. San Bernardino is not that far from here. So that happened here. New York, my family, my friends were in New York in 9/11. And I've got friends in Turkey and Istanbul as we speak that could have been there during that terrorist bombing. I'm sick of it. Aren't we all sick of it? But the answer isn't to play their game and say us versus them, Islam versus non-Islam, West versus East. That helps them. Don't do that. Let's not help them. Let's hurt their cause. Let's, if we can, pulverize their cause. But how do you do that? You do it with a battle of ideas. You say fundamentalism of all of these religions is wrong. We should do things based on logic, based on laws that we have all agreed to in democracies. We should not do it based on whatever your ancient text is. The minute you say, well, the Muslims are wrong, but my text is right, we've lost. Because then what they're going to do is they're going to grab more people to their side and say, see, we told you, the Christians are in a war with you, you better grab a gun, you better grab a bomb. Let's defeat all fundamentalism. I know people think that it's naive. It's not naive. This fundamentalism came from someplace. And I've tracked it on the show before. I've told you one of the reasons was Saudi Arabia that spread Wahhabism with the oil money that they got all throughout. They bought radio stations, television stations, they put it into books, did madrasas and schools, and they spread it all throughout the world. And then the U.S. came in and thought it was a brilliant idea to help Islamic fundamentalism along to fight the godless communists. And then we took our money and we poured it more into the culture to encourage fundamentalism. What a terrible idea that turned out to be. It's literally blowing up in our face. Now, if we did that kind of damage, the Saudis, who are our allies, the U.S., and whoever else participated in it. Well, think about it. If we did it, we can undo it. Is it going to be easy? No, it's going to be enormously hard to undo it. But it can be done. If it was culture and if it was that media that did it in the first place, and they did a coordinated attack on our culture, secular culture, well, we can do a coordinated attack back on their culture. Except we don't do it with bombs, because that plays into their game that says the answer is violence. For secular people, the answer shouldn't be violence. The answer should be, if they're going to try to brainwash you with lies, well, then we're going to try to bring you the facts. And the facts are, none of these texts are true. Muhammad didn't talk to God.
Oh, what a wonderful coincidence. It turns out you should sleep with anyone you like, including people that are in your army, their wives. Other people don't get to play by the same rules. You get special. What a lucky break for Muhammad. Who believes this? Who can believe this stuff? Same thing in Mormonism. What a lucky break for Joseph Smith. It turns out that there's not one thing that has sex with everybody's wives, but everybody's soul. And God never comes and says, hey, let Bob have sex with him. God knows what to tell him. He's going to have sex with him. Great husband, family, supportive in a lot of ways. At that point, she moved to Paris. But she said she couldn't fill that hole in her heart. And that's what a lot of religion prays about. You know, they ask you, what's missing in your life? What's the hole? Right? You're filled with religion. Right or wrong, you're filled with religion. That's what they did with her. Then on February 28th of 2013, Siki told her husband that she was traveling to work in an orphanage in Istanbul for a few weeks and taking their son. Instead, she took the well-worn jihadi route to southern Turkey and came to Syria. As I'm reading the story, I'm like almost screaming, like, no, 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 don't take your four-year-old son. Are you nuts? What are you doing? Don't leave the kid behind. No. Oh, God. My heart breaks for that husband. Okay, so he winds up in Raqqa, Syria. His thought tries to struggle to Raqqa. The reality of daily life was predictably different from the poor paradise painted by our hometown friends. The Siki was ordered not to go out alone, only then covered from head to toe, to hand over her passport to limit communications with her family and friends. So then she realizes, oops, bad idea. She says, I have to go home. Every day I said I miss my family and my son needed to see his father. To begin with, they made excuses, then came the threats. They said I was a woman alone with a child and I couldn't go anywhere. If I tried to leave, I would be stoned or killed. What did you think was going to happen? What did you think they were playing bad things? I can't understand how these people are breaking. But we'll get to that as well. I think that it in some way it affects us all, this brainwashing of religion. So now she realizes what's strange. And so she says, I was terrified someone would come and take me to prison. And I'd have to leave my son with him. I spoke to him all the time. I tried to impress on him things he wouldn't forget. That his father and I loved him, that he had to be kind to girls. I talked to hope he would sink in. That if something happened to me and it fell into Daesh's budget, he would have my voice in his head and would not be able to kill him. I was like a lioness trying to protect him. But, you know, this lioness, here's how you go protect him, by leaving him home in France. So all those efforts. And I feel terrible for her, but it's impossible for me to feel complete sympathy or empathy here, because what are you doing? How insane are you to take this poor kid in? The dad later found pictures of the kid holding a rifle. He's 4 years old. He's so impressionable. If they had actually taken her to prison or she had been killed, you think they can't brainwash him? He's a four-year-old. He would have been lost forever. Oh, heartbreaking. So she continues. Got so bad that I would have killed us both rather than let him become a killer, rather than let him fall into the claws of those monsters. Dan, I wish you'd have thought of that before you left. Okay, now things start to evolve. When one of the Frenchmen demanded to take the boy to pray in the mosque, she snapped, keep your hands off my boy. The response was a punch in the face. What did you think was going to happen? You put this in hundreds of women, let alone the men. Over there, they think there's a paradise up there for women. You think there's a paradise for women where ISIS is in charge? You object that they were taking their MDO mosque. What do you think you're doing inside the what they call the Islamic Caliphate? Okay, she says, I was in a foreign city where I knew nobody and didn't speak the language. I looked at my son and I knew that I had made a monumental mistake, the worst of my life, and to say the least. Okay, now. How the hell is she going to get out of this? Well, that's where we get to the good side of this. The Frenchman took the CP and her son to the Madonna. Yes, that's still the bad part for a second. A prison in Alma, home to dozens of foreign women, where she was shocked to see young children watching ISIS decapitation and killing themselves while their mother was cheered and cried. Jesus Christ, man, what did you bring that kid into that, man? So, at this point, I'm again, that's horrible. I'm dying to get to the good part. But still, so be explained, in the midst of that madness, people bring what they're into. So, the women saw ISIS fighters as their prince charming people, someone who was strong, powerful, and was effective. The only way out of the Madafa was to marry them. In reality, those lesser women were just willing to make babies for them. Okay, so, two things here. I reported on an earlier story where women would be like, oh, cool, prince of a Syrian woman that were in Raqqa already. Oh, like a Saudi prince was one of their fighters. And she got to live in a place with air conditioning. She married him. She was actually kind of excited. And it turns out he committed a suicide bombing and then she had to marry a new guy. But, oh, they're not prince charming. All these guys are just I'm here so that they can have sex with me, have fun, impregnate me so I can have more fighters, then they go off to die. You can bring in someone else, have him have sex with me, more babies, they go off. Yeah! So what did you think was gonna happen? So, not a part of this. So, we're gonna look. We've got a bunch of Canaanites.
Sure, of course that's a valid reason.
later. Back to the dead.
Thank you. Yes. Yes, I ate.
Oh, I love you, brother, but, and I am still,
sacrifice other chances to have a stronger force than the power of Jesus. Person named Jesus. I don't even want to get into all that. There was prophets everywhere. And one of them, he's from Nazareth, gets a lot of people to follow. If you lost something back from the dead, at that time, and then he's like, basically, he's having a party.
Tone of, you're stunning, but why don't you cover up, you little slut, right? Like, that's the way her tweet reads, and I think that's the reason why it got under my skin. I can't stand when women tear other women apart based on the way they look, how they dress. I mean, she's a talented artist. Why don't you comment on how talented she is? Why do you have to comment on her full-length gown with a freaking cape? She's wearing a cape, okay? How many scantily
wears a lot less clothing than her.
That's true.
Right? Although she also has skin. Okay, by the way, can I see Bonnie's picture again? Because, look, that picture you just saw, okay, a little bit of side boob. Now let me see Bonnie.
Children are watching!
Bonnie, what's wrong with you?
There are children online that might come across these images and their heads might explode.
But look, I know this is a different context. She's at events there, not necessarily covering the game, and she might not come to the game that way. But she's, well, wait a minute, Bonnie, to the children. The children, Bonnie.
Children are watching.
Okay. That's not fair to her. They caught her at a moment in time, and that's happened to the best of us. Okay, let's act that off. Okay. But when you want to talk, like, the first picture, just the normal picture of her, well, I saw a lot of her side boob. Nothing wrong with that.
Not even side. She used to see cleavage, right?
Right.
And look, it's fine. I don't care about cleavage. I don't care about women who are scantily clad. I don't care about men who are scantily clad. Who cares? Who cares? I just think it's very childish and immature to start looking at the clothing of our peers and judging them based on that. Just let it go. Look, you work for Sports Network. I'm sure you have a great career. Find something more interesting to comment on than a woman wearing a full-length gown and a cape. That's all I have to say about it.
Yeah. And by the way, she's not alone. Of course people, they get antsy. And they look at that and they go, no, I have to complain about something.
Look, the only reason why nudity is a big deal in this country is because we make it a big deal, right? Like, this is one of the, well, there are lots of countries, but I think the U.S. is one of the countries that puts way too much weight on, like, our bodies, and, oh my God, it's obscene, we gotta cover up. Just calm down, it's not that big of a deal. Again, no one was gonna comment about this, kids weren't even gonna notice it until she brought it up.
Okay, I'm gonna go on a crazy tangent here for a second, because it's related to what I was saying the first time. Look, the whole reason we care about our bodies and the bodies are taboo and cover up and all that stuff is because you've got to make more children to fight against the Canaanites, okay? And so, don't have sex outside of marriage. Make sure that it's in marriage, but then you don't spill your seed. Have a million kids because we need an army. We need an army. So that stuff that they came up with 2,500 years ago to fight the Canaanites is still haunting us today, so that if we see a piece of a person's body, we're like, oh my God, it's a national scandal. Wakey, 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 the whole world, wakey, wakey. That's some old crap. Put it aside. If you're going to be concerned about anything for the kids, you should be 1,000 times more concerned about the violence rather than the nudity. And there was no nudity. All right.
All right. London's Daily Telegraph did something that some journalists working for the company were not too fond of. Apparently, they came to work one day and they noticed that there were monitoring devices placed underneath their desks. And of course, the journalists wanted to know why the hell this is happening. Why are we being monitored? So apparently, they found out after some investigative Google work that the reporters learned that the Occupy branded boxes were actually motion-detecting devices. Following the workers' discovery, the newspaper emailed the staff to let them know that, yes, their desk time is now being monitored. Now, the higher-ups at the Telegraph, the Daily Telegraph, basically responded to the complaints by saying, no, this isn't about keeping an eye on you. This is not about Big Brother watching you. This is about making sure that we focus on energy efficiency.
Yeah.
So if you're not at your desk, then maybe we won't use, you know, our heating system, or we won't use the lights. We'll automatically shut those things off. Those are the claims that they're making. But the journalists feel very differently about it. Now, the monitors are meant to help with the company. This is the statement from the executives at the publication. The monitors are meant to help the company save money and resources by reducing the amount of power we consume for heating, lighting, and cooling the building at times of low usage. Yeah.
Excuse me. Then they came up with a lot of different excuses. Oh, no, we're just going to keep them on there for 4 weeks to see, you know, the energy ebb and flow for efficiency and stuff. We're going to take them out anyway. We plan to take them out. And then people were super pissed, and then journalist organizations started to complain, like the UK's National Union of Journalists.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, yeah, we meant we're taking them out right away. Yeah, that's what we meant.
Yeah, they did end up removing them, which is good. And they did release a statement to their employees saying, we will be looking at alternative ways to gather the environmental sustainability data we need,
sure,
and we'll keep staff in touch with any new proposals. I don't believe them either. I think this was about, you know, making sure that their journalists are at work doing their jobs. I think a good way of determining whether or not your journalists are doing their jobs is whether or not they meet their deadlines, whether or not their pieces are good, do they fact check. I mean, there are very simple ways that you can ensure that your employees are doing their jobs. Having motion detectors placed under their desks without warning them ahead of time, not the best way, if you ask me.
Yeah. And it wasn't, you couldn't even place something else there to trick the detectors, because it also monitors heat that comes off of a human body,
yeah.
Not just motion, right? So, I hate this. And I'm an employer here at TYT. I'm the boss, not a maker. Okay? But I would hate doing this to employees. And when I was an employee, I don't know why, but it was my pet peeve. Like, stop looking over my shoulder. I got it, dude. I'm an adult. I'm working. I don't need you to come and go. Right?
Yeah. At other places that I worked, I hated when I was sitting at my desk watching porn, and then somebody would come and give me a hard time about it. I'm getting my work done. Let me have a little fun.
Yeah.
Okay?
To me, the only thing that matters, and it does matter, and people, we all got to be professionals. We all got to do our jobs, right? But the bottom line is results. So I don't care. Go sit your ass back down on the chair. Sit your ass back down. I don't need to be your parent, right? And don't treat your employees like they're children, right?
Mm-hmm.
So give them responsibilities. Treat them like adults. And some of them do the job. Some of them don't. That's a reality. Yes. Okay? But you don't need to track every motion of this. Where'd you go? Where'd you go? Where'd you go? Oh, you were in the bathroom too long. Noted for the record. Lunch. Hey, stayed an hour and 15 minutes for lunch. Noted for the record. Get off our ass, man. Get off our ass. Especially if you're at a paper, the Daily Telegraph, and then you're going to spy in on your own employees. No, not buying it that it was for energy efficiency. If it was for energy efficiency, you could have placed it on the walls, in so many different places. You happen to place it at all the desks, the individual desks. No, it was to track your employees, and it was a horrible move. And I'm glad you got busted on it, and I'm glad that you've now backpedaled on it.
Yeah. You're a pretty good boss.
You think so?
Yeah. I mean, you're not on our asses all the time, and that's good.
Maybe I should be more.
But, I mean, I have a really good employee, so maybe he just realizes he doesn't need to be on my ass. Like, you know?
Jesus, let's order some of those boxes.
All right. Michigan's notorious sex toy bandits who got engaged at a Walmart started a GoFundMe page in order to pay for their own wedding. Lots of twists and turns in this story, so let me tell you how it all goes. So William J. Cornelius Jr. proposed to his now fiance at a Walmart, and then afterwards they proceeded to steal items from a Spencer's gift store, and then they got arrested. Now, of course, they're having a hard time paying for their wedding, so they started a GoFundMe page for $10,000. But GoFundMe took their page down. Now, let me give you some more details according to Michigan Live. Cornelius, 25, on the evening of Wednesday, December 30th, went to Walmart. He bought her a ring for $29.62, then asked a customer service worker to read a proposal note over the public address system, asking her to marry him. Staff provided Bay County Sheriff's deputies with surveillance camera footage showing the event, with Cornelius and the woman hugging and kissing as people stand around them and applaud. And that's according to the court records.
Okay, let's pause here because this story is about to take a lot of turns, right? So that twist,
yeah.
I love these guys.
Yeah.
It's like totally heartwarming $29 ring.
Yeah.
He does it on a Walmart speaker. Awesome. America is totally on your side, right? Then as the story evolves and you start to see them stealing one thing after another, you begin to wonder, wait, was that a trick?
Mm-hmm.
Was that a part of a strategy to eventually set up the GoFundMe site?
Probably.
Right, I mean, what a warm, heartwarming story, and they're at Walmart and they need money for their wedding.
So Cenk has a very good reason for suspecting this, and I'll tell you why. We'll get to some more of the twists that will explain why they're a little shady, right? Mm-hmm. So the couple went to Spencer's Gifts right after their engagement, where deputies alleged they stole a watch, an edible thong, a sex toy, panties, and sex candy that was valued at about $80.93.
I'm going to pause here, too. First off, God, stealing an edible thong is wonderful. Because, you know, push comes to shove, you can just eat the evidence. What edible thong? I don't know what you're talking about, right? Okay, but more importantly, I look at these poor sons of bitches and I think, dude, if you worked on Wall Street, you could steal $80 million, and then the government would be on your side and help you in that theft,
Right.
And you're going to go steal a dildo for $80.93, and then you're going to stuff it in your pants, and the cops are going to catch you, and it's going to be embarrassing. Like, I just, they don't know how to steal, right?
They don't know how to steal. Yeah, I mean, I would think that it would be smarter to go after something that has more value, more resale value. I feel like they just really wanted to celebrate their engagement in a sexy way.
That's right, which then creates another twist in the story where I think maybe the whole Walmart GoFundMe thing was not a savvy trick.
Yeah.
That these dudes are just like, hi, which is, we find out later in the story, they might have been. Mm-hmm. And they're like, let's get married. Yo, look, edible bugs.
So, look, they're 20, 25, that's Cornelius, and then his unidentified bride is 20. They're young, they're stupid, they're making bad decisions in life. Now, the GoFundMe page had a really sad message. Of course, we don't know whether or not the message is true, but let me tell you what it said. And again, GoFundMe took the page down because they did not follow their community guidelines or whatever it is, okay? So, yes, we are the sex toy bandits. We are real people with real problems. We need help raising money for our wedding because I am currently pregnant and homeless. We do not want our baby born out of wedlock. Anything will help. Thank you for taking the time to read our story, and thank you in advance for the help.
So I look at that, and I think this is the new, slightly more sophisticated way of the guy coming up to you in the parking lot and going, oh, man, I forgot my wallet, and I need $2 for the bus ride, and I got to get to my family. Like, how many times have you heard that? I remember the first time that my mom, Wendy, first heard, like, oh my God, the guy's got to get to his family. He needs $2.
Yes.
Like, baby, come back in half an hour. You're going to be shocked to find out he still hasn't taken that bus. Right? So now the new way of doing that is, oh my God, this happened to me and that happened to me. And can everybody in the world just go to my GoFundMe page and then give me millions of dollars? And everybody's riding high on that. So then I thought the twist is that the whole thing had been a setup for this.
Yeah.
Right? But then you read into it, and they're so unsophisticated that I think they just stumbled from one happenstance to another. That she got pregnant, she's pregnant, so he proposed at the Walmart, and then they were like high, and like literally the guy was high, by the way, we found out later. And they went to the edible thongs, and they got the thing, the dildos or whatever they got, you know. And
I love your gesture for dildos.
This is mainly double dong. Okay. This is dildo. This is double dong.
Oh my goodness.
Okay. Anyway. So then they are like, hey, maybe we do the GoFundMe scam.
Yep.
Maybe then we'll get paid. By the way, they got zero donations before they got shut down. So they sent this to everybody. People are like, okay, we're not going to fund your dildos. We're not going to fund your wedding. We're not going to do any of that. Besides what you got to get down. My favorite part of the story is finally, she gets caught, okay, and she goes, now, I didn't do it, and I'm not going to tell you who the culprit is, and I'm not going to rat out Cornelius. Like, yeah, dude, you just told us it was Cornelius. Right? So then they go get Cornelius, and then meanwhile, she's like, fine, it was Cornelius. Okay, so it has the most unromantic ending of all time. And now, back to Cornelius, they catch him, where? He's still at the mall. At the food court in the mall, and he passed out while tying his shoelaces. So he's like, because he was high. So they're like, Cornelius, yeah, we're going to need that donger back. And you're under arrest.
How have they not created a reality show around them?
Old?
I know.
Okay, just wait.
And second question, is it frowned upon to start a GoFundMe page to pay for your wedding? I'm not saying anything. I just feel like these people aren't as dumb as people are making them out to be. Okay?
Okay, well, I mean, so far the results show otherwise. $0 raised and in prison.
Right.
So perhaps there's a better way.
You need
to
some publicity behind that GoFundMe page if you know what I'm talking about.
Hey, look, that's up to you. Somebody's getting married! Okay. Don't steal any sex toys first. None of this.
No, I don't need to steal them. I have a good inventory. All right. Police officials in Fresno, California are being questioned about the way they're surveilling their residents. And the way they're doing it is a very comprehensive plan, a very comprehensive strategy. Now, they don't do what most police departments do, which is rely on federal databases or local databases. They're using a new software that combines all the databases you could think of and also gives individual scores based on what they've posted in the public, specifically on social media. So let me give you some details on that. A new generation of technology such as the Beware software being used in Fresno has given local police officials unprecedented power to peer into the lives of citizens. So just to give you some detailed examples of that, on 57 monitors that cover the walls of the police station, operators zoomed and panned an array of roughly 200 police cameras perched across the city. They could dial up 800 more feeds from the city's schools and traffic cameras, and they soon hope to add 400 more streams from cameras worn on officers' bodies and from thousands from local businesses that have surveillance systems. Officers could also troll a private database that has recorded more than 2 billion scans of vehicle license plates and locations nationwide. If gunshots were fired, a system called Shot Spotter could triangulate the location using microphones strung around the city. Another program called Media Sonar crawled social media looking for illicit activity. Police used it to monitor individuals, threats to schools, and hashtags related to gangs. Now, the last part of that is what I really want to focus on because it's problematic. It's based on what people post on social media. And oftentimes what you post on social media isn't necessarily something you really mean, or it's not representative of who you are. There was a city council member that questioned their strategy in surveilling people, and he's like, well, why don't you use this software on me right now? I want to see what turns up. And so it found that he was green, meaning that he's not a threat. However, his home showed up as yellow, meaning that someone living in that home could be a threat, right? Mm-hmm. And he's like, well, I'm not a threat. You know, no one in my family is a threat. It must be someone who used to live at that house. And so what if we need the police for something and then you guys see that it's a yellow house? You're going to show up, you know, paranoid. And that's not good. It's not an accurate representation of me or my family members.
The police showing up somewhere paranoid? It would never happen in America. Okay, so look, as usual with these things, it's a mixed bag. So if someone you know was hurt in a crime, would you want them to be able to triangulate and find on camera who it was and bring them to justice and punish them? You would. So that's why it's really alluring. It gets people to go, wow, that sounds pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine someone you know is mugged or raped or killed. I mean, I want to find a son of a bitch who did it, and this could help us do it. Now, that's the good side. The bad side is, well, okay, now we're into thought crimes as we talk about what they're doing in social media. And then there's the part that's totally misleading. I mean, how many memes have you seen that involve violence when the person didn't mean violence at all? Al Pacino pointing a shotgun, say hello to my little friend. He's not actually going to show you his little friend. Okay, but gangster rap, violent movies, Goodfellas, Scarface, whatever it might be, right? Okay, now it's also misleading. Now, and then cops are already trigger happy in this country, and now you're going to show them a yellow light or a red light at a house. Oh, Jesus Christ.
Right.
And then there's a third element of the downside, which is, we're all being monitored, and that's Big Brother. So you can't do anything in public now without them having it on tape somewhere.
Exactly, yeah.
And to me, I don't know, there's something wrong with me, but I don't think so. I think it's a natural human urge. That is unnerving to me. I don't like that. I don't like that the government is tracking me at all times.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. I mean, before, yeah, it makes sense to have certain surveillance systems in place to ensure that, you know, if there's a shooting or a robbery in a public setting, you have some evidence of that. So you can go ahead and prosecute, you can bring people to justice. So you're right, it is a mixed bag. But I think relying on social media in any way, shape, or form is a really bad idea, especially given cases in the past where innocent kids, for instance, got targeted by police officials because they posted rap lyrics on Facebook. Rap lyrics are violent. You know, a lot of rap lyrics are violent. That doesn't mean that the person posting them or even the person who wrote them is a violent person. It's a form of expression. It's a form of art. Some people don't like it. I get that. But again, that's not a representation of the people who post it, oftentimes. So I worry about that, and I do worry about our privacy and feeling comfortable in a public setting. Right now, I don't feel comfortable in a public setting.
And for the moment being, we think that they're going to use it on crime, but even so, it has all of these disadvantages we just listed for you. But imagine it's everywhere, and yes, a lot of the government officials might be decent, good people, and cops might be good people looking to prevent crime. Some of them are not going to be good people,
and then they're going to track their wives or ex-husbands or current husbands, and then they're going to say, okay, you went gambling, you went, oh, what kind of massage did you get? Why did you go to the bank? Why did you take out that money, right? And why did you see Bob? Why did you see Susie? And on it goes. And now you've given an enormous amount of power to these government officials. Now, some on the right, I hear, don't like that. So if you don't like that, you might want to think about this program that's very, very real, okay? And it's coming to a neighborhood near you, and it's about to assess your terror threat. Better hope it's right.
All right, let's take our break. When we come back, Scott Walker responds to calls to pardon Stephen Avery, the subject of Making a Murder.
Go. Union coverage tonight, tytnetwork.com/live. That's going to be at 8:45 p.m. Eastern. Jimmy's back, Johnny Pye is back, Ben is back, so we're going to do that pregame at 5:45 Pacific, 8:45 Eastern, then play-by-play while the speech is happening, and that one we could actually show you, and then a little bit post-game coverage as well. Member shout-outs. Daniela Bickle is member number 1574, and Humberto Jimenez is member number 1541. The post game today, I'm going to show you a video I recorded while I was high. So that's at tydnetwork.com/join to become a member. By the way, we're also covering the GOP debate on Thursday night live. That's at 9 p.m. Eastern. And then we're going to cover the Democratic debate Sunday at 3 in the morning. No, it's not 3 in the morning. But if Debbie Wasserman Schultz had it her way, it would be. But it is Sunday night. All of that, of course, at tydnetwork.com/live. Okay, Joe Oliver writes in, let's watch college kids get brain damage. Tits! That's unacceptable. There's kids watching. Paul Simon writes in, Jesus didn't even have that hard of a job. Wine is already 80% water. I always thought Jesus was a little overrated. Okay, that's funny. Hunter writes in, it's a Telegraph, an actually right-wing paper. Their owners are aggressive, non-dom businessmen, dry machine men. Okay, that sounds very British. Didn't understand the last part at all.
Yeah, sometimes they have really good articles, though. I gotta keep it real.
Oh, really?
Yeah, for the most part, I like the Telegraph.
Oh, interesting. I don't have a strong opinion on them, but I hear you, and thank you for dropping that knowledge about how they're right-wing. I'm going to have to figure out what non-dom businessmen are. It sounds a little sexual. And dry machine men is...
Does non-dom mean, like, non-dominant? Like,
I guess so. Oh. Are they submissive? Okay, anyway, that was fun. Julia Mahoney writes, in a job like journalism shouldn't be measured by the quantity of time at the desk, but by the quality of the story that is written. Julia, you're obviously right, but I wanted that triggered a thought in me. The other thing I wanted to say in the middle of the story is, if you're a journalist, I don't want you sitting at your desk. I want you to out there trying to get a story. Mm-hmm. Can you imagine Jordan now is, you know, our reporter in the field. And I'm like, Jordan, I had a tracking device on your ass, and it wasn't sitting enough. What were you doing at that Trump rally? Like, no, you want your reporter out in the field doing stuff.
Yes.
Okay, speaking of that, Donald J. Troll writes in, I got a way to shut up those anti-boob conservative moms. Tell them if the kids see the boobs, they won't grow up gay.
Yeah.
That's fine.
But Donald is on a roll, man. I feel like Donald gets mentioned every show.
Donald J. Troll?
Yes.
Yeah. He's Donald J. Troll. He's supposed to get it through, isn't he? Isn't that the whole point of Troll?
I think Donald J. Troll is actually a woman.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. A tweet that was sent to me by this individual made me think it was a woman. I don't know. I could be wrong. Tweet to me and let me know.
All right, sounds fun. And he or she got that from, I believe, from the graphic that we had about Trump trolling everybody, which people seem to enjoy. All right, what's next?
All right. Hundreds of thousands of people have signed a petition begging for government officials to pardon Stephen Avery, the subject of the widely popular Netflix documentary series Making a Murderer. Well, unfortunately, since he wasn't convicted on a federal level, the president or federal officials are unable to grant him a pardon. However, Scott Walker, who is the governor of Wisconsin, could pardon him. However, he refuses to do so. Now, understand that based on Scott Walker's statements on this issue, it's very clear that he, A, knows very little about the situation, and B, doesn't really care much to learn or investigate Stephen Avery's conviction. However, here's what he had to say. He says, I don't believe we should undermine the criminal justice system. And this is a prime example. Stephen Avery was convicted by a jury of his peers for brutal, brutal rape and murder of a 25-year-old, he says girl, but it was a woman. 25-year-old people are either men or women. The Court of Appeals heard his appeal, and the state Supreme Court heard his appeal. He's gone through all the processes. Okay, so here's the thing. It frustrates me because he doesn't want to undermine the work of prosecutors. He feels that that's the wrong thing to do. There are lots of crooked prosecutors out there. There are lots of people who have been either pardoned or exonerated for wrongful convictions. Okay, so for you to say, like, I don't want to undermine the prosecutors, well, I think that in and of itself is a miscarriage of justice. There's supposed to be certain checks and balances in place to ensure that, you know, you right the wrongs of some officials. And if you watch that documentary series, there were lots of terrible things that went on that led to this conviction.
So there's a reason why a pardon exists in our system. It's one, if you have a crooked prosecutor, it's a check and balance that Anna talked about. But two, what if you made a mistake? There wasn't a crooked prosecutor. You just had the wrong guy. You had the wrong evidence. And then, for example, DNA evidence later has proven many cases we just simply had wrong. That's the reason why you have this system and a Or maybe you punish the person, but you punish them way too harshly, and society has changed now and goes, hey, wait a minute, we've rethought that issue. There's a reason why the pardon exists. To me, the more outrageous thing that Scott Walker said was the other quote. He said, I have made it my practice for the last 5 years to not issue pardons.
Yep.
I don't believe we should undermine the criminal justice system, and this is a prime example. No, but that, what you're saying is, I refuse to do my job. Part of your job is to issue pardons. Now, it's not to say that you must issue pardons. Maybe you could, it's feasible, possible, I suppose, that you could look at the thousands of cases that come across a governor's desk and decide none of them are worthwhile, right? But you're at least supposed to do your job and read them.
Yes.
You're supposed to look at them. You're supposed to look at the evidence and go, okay, that makes sense. That doesn't make sense. I'm going to use my judgment and the power vested in me by the good people of Wisconsin. You're not supposed to go, that's kind of a pain in the ass. I'm tough on crime,
yeah.
Even on the innocent. I'm super tough on the innocent. So pardons, cases, who cares? I'm not reading them. I'm never issuing a pardon. And that's a dereliction of duty. That's outrageous.
It is outrageous. And the fact that he has no interest in looking in this case is the part that outrages me the most. Like, God, look, this is a huge spoiler alert. If you haven't watched the documentary series, I guess stop listening to what we're about to say. But there's one portion that shows, like, one big piece of evidence that the prosecution had was that Stephen Avery's blood was in Teresa Halbach's truck, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the defense attorneys went to the county because they knew there was a vial of blood belonging to Stephen Avery there. Because remember, he was already wrongfully convicted of a rape that he did not do. He was wrongfully convicted. So the county already had some DNA of him, the vial of blood. They found that the vial of blood had been punctured. Someone had fucked with the vial of blood, okay? So it's very likely that they, you know, planted the blood in the truck. And another thing that was interesting was that there were no handprints of Stephen Avery at all in that truck.
Not a single one. Just conveniently, the blood they happen to already have.
Exactly.
Okay, next time, get his handprints, too, if you'd like to frame him. So the follow-up question that should have been asked to Scott Walker is, we know Stephen Avery was wrongly convicted before of the rape. That has already been proven. Would you still not have pardoned him, even knowing that he was wrongly convicted? Because you said you don't do any pardons.
Man, it's depressing.
And look, again, it's Republican governor. They're so proud of being bad people. Like, I have no mercy. I'll never show any mercy. I'll never show any kindness to anyone. Aren't I awesome? And unfortunately, about half the population goes, yeah, no mercy, kill them. You're guilty, innocent, who cares, don't care, let's just go get them. Man, there is an ugly side to humanity, and it usually looks like Scott Walker.
I'm just going to leave you guys with this stat, because I looked into it after I watched this documentary. I'm obsessed with the justice system. The Innocence Project, which is an organization that seeks to exonerate wrongfully convicted people, has used DNA evidence to basically free around 330 individuals. 330 people convicted of crimes that they were not, you know, actually guilty of. They were able to free using DNA evidence. I think there were about 7 cases that they were able to do that didn't even involve DNA evidence. Wrongful convictions happen. There are people who have been murdered by our country for crimes that they didn't commit, okay? We just got to be a little smarter about the reality of our justice system right now. There's lots of laws, and for any type of politician to say, no, we don't do pardons, that's our policy, well, that's wrong. It's beyond wrong.
Terrorist watch list. Oh, it could have mistakes, so let most of the terrorists get weapons anyway. Death row. Could have mistakes. Sorry, just kill them anyway. Is that amazing? Is that amazing that they think that those two things are wrong? Final thought on this. Scott Walker might have fucked up. Look, he has survived many things in Wisconsin. I know. So don't count on Scott Walker, unless he's running for president, which he's laughed your ass off. But people are really pissed about this.
Oh, yeah.
And a lot of people have watched this. So it's not just Democrats. There are Republicans who are like, wait a minute, you got the wrong guy, right? Yes, believe it or not, there are decent Republicans out there, and especially independents. And if this Scott Walker's like, yeah, who cares? So what? Screw Steve Avery. A lot of people who watch that be like, note to self, Scott Walker is a real asshole, right? So Who knows, man? It's sometimes the little stuff like this that gets you. There's all these investigations that they've used the wrong computers. Nobody gives a shit about that. If they watch this, they care, right? So he might have fucked up here. So we'll see. Only time will tell. All right.
All right. Last story. Okay.
Real quick.
All right. I don't even know how to start this. All right. If you're a millennial, it's apparently a good idea to switch jobs every 3 years. That's according to some CEOs, some higher-ups in big companies, especially tech companies, that don't believe it's necessarily a good idea for you to pick a company and stay with them till you're ready to retire. Okay, so this was an article published by Fast Company, and they quote a number of people who think it's a great idea to basically job hop. Go from one place to another. Let me give you the details on that. So, apparently workers who stay with a company longer than 2 years are said to get paid 50% less, and job hoppers are believed to have a higher learning curve, be higher performers, and even be more loyal. I don't know how that even makes sense.
Yeah, it does not make sense.
Because they care about making a good impression in the short amount of time they know they'll stay at each employer. Now, millennials do job hop. But they don't job hop because they want to. Oftentimes, you know, the company that they're with doesn't give them the benefits that they need, or they won't get hired as full-time employees. There's a huge issue with underemployment, which I know you'd think doesn't exist. But, you know, people who get hired as part-timers because the company doesn't want to pay for their insurance or give them benefits and things like that.
So all that is true, but also millennials have ADHD, or think they do. And so, and they're always looking for something better. Oh, there's magical, wonderful things out there.
Yeah.
Oh, the next company's going to be amazing. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So, by the way, I'm partly buying this, believe it or not, right? Mm-hmm. So, I just told you the part I'm not buying. The part I do buy is that, yeah, you do build different experience and expertise at different companies, right? And so, sometimes hopping can help you, especially because I know from my experience when I was working for somebody else, sometimes you get typecast at a company. Like, you came in at a certain level, and at that company I came in really low, and I came in at a sales position and then hop on air. And I remember one of the reporters later when I became a supervising producer saying, why am I taking directions from the sales kid? Right?
Yeah.
So sometimes the hopping does make sense. But overall, saying that hopping is the right idea, of course, is not true. It depends on the situation.
Yes.
So you have to, as an employer, you got to look, wait, is this guy hop too much, hop too little, right? I mean, you take all that into account. And as an employer, you got to look out, yes, for the company and be loyal to it, no question, and also, obviously, for your career. So the answer is, a big fat, it depends. You got to use your judgment. Be smart about it.
Yeah. This article was a match, and it lit my ass on fire. Right? Because I've been here for like 9 years, and I was like, oh my god, I'm not job hopping, I'm a millennial, what about my learning curve? Am I getting paid 50% less than other millennials? Like, what do I need to do about this?
See, but that's exactly the problem with millennials.
No, though. I know, but here's, I'm not going anywhere, I love my job, everything's great, right? But you do need to continuously, you know, up your skill level. And it's true, like, once you're comfortable in one company, and you already know everything about that company, you feel like you've hit a ceiling. And so my solution for that is, if you've got a good gig, stick to that good gig. If you love your job, stick to it. Don't let alarmist articles like this convince you that you need to leave. However, do shit on the side, right? So, like, with writing, I mean, I don't write at TYT, but I write at Raw Story, and I love it. It's teaching me things about, you know, this field that I didn't know before that I love. And if there are other projects, I can do that as well. Some companies want you to be exclusive. That sucks. I think that's stupid, right? But if you can do other things on the side, and you're motivated enough to do it, go for it. That's what I think.
Okay, listen. It all depends. Sometimes doing things on the side is the right way to go. Sometimes saying, hey, you know what, I would like a new challenge at this company makes sense. I'd like to try something different, right? I'd like to add to my experience or expertise in another field.
Mm-hmm.
Those are all legitimate things, and you should talk to your, you know, managers about that. Mm-hmm. And I think that they would actually like that because you're showing initiative.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, I've done that too.
So. Okay.
So now, keeping it 100.
Okay. But what I don't want you to do either way is panic, right? Because there's a lot of different paths to the right goal. So one might be, hey, I'm going to get different experiences and then move here. Or it might be, I'm going to specialize and I'm going to be the best in the world at this,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I do that too.
Oh, yeah. Can we end this already? So just calm down. Everything. Everything's going to be all right. There's a lot of different ways to get to the right place. Okay? And don't listen to any experts that tell you, there's only one way. You must hop jobs every 3 years, otherwise you're falling behind. Okay, that's not true. All right. So, we got to go, guys. State of the Union is coming up. So we'll be back in 43 minutes for live coverage of that. TYTnetwork.com/live, obviously. And for those of you who are members, video for Vegas of When I Was High. That's fun. TYTnetwork.com/join.
Bye-bye.